like that. Mark chapter number 8, verse number 22. Praying last night, the Lord laid this on my heart, and some things I'd never noticed before. And just praying, asking God to help us. And I seem like the Lord just impressed this scripture upon my heart. Mark chapter number 8, verse number 22. Bruce, you turn me up just a little bit. I'm having trouble with my voice. And he cometh to Bethsaida, and they bring a blind man unto him and besought him to touch him. And he looked, he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the town. And when he had spat on his eyes and put his hands upon him, he asked him if he saw aught. And he looked up and said, I see men as trees walking. After that, he put his hands again upon his eyes and made him look up. And he was restored and saw every man clearly. And he sent him away in his house, saying, neither go into the town nor tell it to any in the town. And the Bible said in verse 23, and he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes, he put his hands upon him and asked him if he saw aught. I never really knew the purpose of that question. And I've never really understood that. I mean, Jesus knows everything. And maybe he was seeing what that man would say. But he asked him, amen, what he saw. And the Lord will help us tonight. This little thought came to my mind. And I want to try to preach to us on the story of a second touch. Amen, the story of a second touch. Now, this man was like the woman we talked about this morning, one of the unnamed people of the Bible. The Word of God does not give us his name and does not tell us where he's from. Amen. You know, back in those days, a name meant a lot. And when a man was given a name, it had great significance. Amen. It meant something to him, and it meant something to his parents that gave that name to him. But this man's name is not mentioned. Does not tell us how old he was. Does not tell us what town he came from, just that this man was blind. Now, I don't necessarily believe this man was blind from birth. And I'll tell you why I say that. Now, this is not Matthew Henry, but this is what I believe and what I felt like I'd get out of this. The Bible said that he restored his sight. And to restore something is to bring back to its former use. And also, he said, when he opened his eyes that first time, he said, I see men as trees walking. Amen. So he knew what trees and men look like. Maybe he had heard stories and formed them in his mind. But I believe that this man at one time had sight. But something in life, maybe an accident or disease has come upon him. Or maybe it could have been at birth. I don't know. But now this man is blind. Can you imagine? I mean, close your eyes just for a moment and imagine what this man went through on a daily basis. Amen. There was no light. There was no hope of a sunrise or sunset. Amen. He did not see the green of the trees and the green of the grass. Amen. He did not see the blue of the sky. If he had a family, he did not see his wife and children's faces. But he lived in a dark, dark world. Amen. Can you imagine that? I remember when I was in college at South Georgia. Amen. I was in a sociology class. And they were teaching on trust. And in that class, he had people do things and different things to show themselves, to confront their fears. I remember in one class, he took several of us boys and he blindfolded us. Amen. Actually put a hood over our head and then tied something around that hood so we could not see. And for about 30 minutes, we were at the mercy of our partner. Amen. That partner led us everywhere that we went. And I thought about how hopeless and how helpless I felt at that time. Amen. Not knowing if he was leading me into the middle of the road. And not knowing if he was leading me to a room to leave me by myself and try to find my way back. And maybe at times this man felt that same way. Amen. Maybe at times he felt like that he had no hope and he felt helpless in life. Have you ever been there? I mean, you look around and everybody else is talking about how beautiful the day is, how great things are going in life. But to you, it seems like darkness has enveloped and surrounded you on every side. It seems like others sing songs of joy and talk of inspiration and the mighty hand of God. All you know is the rain and sorrow of pain and sorrow and grief. Amen. Maybe that's how that man felt. Or maybe it was that in life, disease had came upon him and took away his sight. I know men just like that. Amen. Men that knew God and saw the glory of the Lord manifested in their lives and their hearts. Amen. Only to get disease of sin and take away their sight, they become blind as they once were. I said they become blind as they once were. Amen. Whether it was by birth, whether it was by disease or accident, this man was blind. And now we see Jesus enters into the picture. And you know something's going to happen when Jesus shows up. Amen. That's the great thing about him. When Jesus comes on the scene, amen, those things thought impossible becomes possible. Amen. Those things thought as being not able to touch, amen, are touched and helped by the power of God. Amen. Jesus comes into the town, and here this man is. And the Bible said one of the first things that Jesus did was he got him by the hand. And the Bible said that he led him out of the city. Amen. He led him out of the city. Amen. There was a brother, Brother Munoz, that lived in Panama when I was there. And him and Brother Frankie were good friends. And I went to his house several times. And I'd always thought he was, I couldn't see very well. I didn't know he was blind. Amen. One night he came to church and I watched him as his girls grabbed him by the arms and they got him off that little, got him out of that taxi and they led him up the steps and talking to him and saying, Daddy, there's a step. Amen. It was the high steps going up into the sanctuary. And when they got him, they walked him in and said, Daddy, here's a seat. And they kind of slid him over and he fell and he sat down. And that was the first time that I knew that man was completely blind. I'd been in his house probably 6 or 7 times. Every time I went, he got up. He'd come to the door and you'd say, hello, Brother Munoz. He'd say, hello, Brother Yeomans. Hello, Brother Alvarino. And he'd go back, sit down. I've seen him get up, walk, go straight to the bathroom and come back. I've seen him go back to his room and bring something back. I don't know how he'd done it. Maybe he knew it was 5 steps to the right. Amen. 5 steps straight to the left. Amen. But he had had it in his mind. When he got up in that familiar setting, he knew exactly where to go and what to do. Amen. He bypassed all the obstacles. Amen. Nothing tipped him up, though it seemed. Amen. But when he got out of the setting, he needed help. I don't know, Jesus talked in Matthew, and he said the mighty works, amen, that had been done, amen, in these other places that had been done, amen, in Sodom and Gomorrah, amen, they might still be alive. All these people had seen the miracles of God, but they did not believe. Maybe he had got around a crowd of people, amen, that talked about Christ, and
how that he was stirring up, how that he was upsetting, or maybe he got so familiar with Bethsaida, amen, that Jesus said, I got to get him out of town, into an unfamiliar setting, amen, get him out of that comfort zone, that healing might come. Amen. You know, a lot of folks talk about, I'd like to have this, and I'd like to have this in my life. I sure like to see the Lord move. But when it comes by, grab them by the hand and says, I'm going to lead you out of trouble. I'm going to lead you out of addiction. I'm going to lead you out of depression. All I need you to do is follow me. He finds that they let go. He finds that they're too complacent where they are. They're surrounded. Are familiar to them. Amen. That unknown, they just can't understand. But then there are those that have got so desperate of where they're at. Amen. They've come to the place, whether it's in the city or outside. Amen. I gotta have a touch from God. He grabs them by the hand and says, let's go. And they come to their feet and they wholeheartedly follow Jesus. Amen. Till the touch comes. Amen. You know what I feel like the Lord would like to do tonight. He'd like to grab you by your hand. Amen. Get you out of that place of familiarity. Get you off that pew of complacency. Amen. Get you out of that place of apathy. And pull you out. And do a work in your life. Amen. I've seen folks that had to do some extraordinary things to get their healing. Amen. I've seen folks come up and they're anointed with oil. Amen. Nobody shouts, hardly no tears shed, just that prayer of faith. And all of a sudden they go home and they testify that God miraculously healed them. Amen, Sister Marcia. Amen. A sage has testified at that day that Brother amen, Cornette was here that God touched her body. It wasn't no shouting. Amen. Nobody got really happy that day. I mean, it was a good move of the Spirit. Amen. But God came softly by. But there's been times when I've seen people cross across the floor. Amen. There's been times when I've seen them run out the doors. There's been times when I've seen them pour on their head till it ran down their cheeks. You know why? Because God was leading them out. He was saying, I got something for you. I've got a better life. I've got better situations. I've got a touch. But you're going to have to follow me. Amen. I want you to look at his method here. We got the man that's blind. And then we got the method of Christ. Amen. Christ comes to this man. Now, he could just as easily lay hands on him. I mean, all he had to do, you know, that second touch, he put his hands on him. And the Bible said that he received his sight and he saw men clearly. Amen. I mean, he restored that sight on that second touch. Amen. But after Jesus had led him out, amen, said he got him by the hand. Amen. Here a while back, I preached on the miracle in the mud, how Jesus spat in that mud and he made clay or made a kind of a putty and he put it in that man's eye. And he received his sight. Said, go wash in the pool of Siloam. And that's exactly what he did. Amen. You won't talk about sanctification. Amen. Here's sanctification right here. I mean, Jesus spat right in his eye. Walked up to that man and spat in his eye. Ain't that what the Bible says? Amen. He said he spit in his eye. Amen. A lot of folks would say, you ain't doing that to me. Come on now, preacher. You better not mess up my hair when you pray. Hey, but somebody say amen. I'll say it by myself. Amen. Come on now. You better not single me out tonight. You better not call on me. Yeah, I'd like to get a touch, but I don't want it that bad. Amen. Jesus spat in his eye. I don't know if he ran back smelling a boy. I don't know how he did it. But whether he did it ran back or just standing there, he spat in his eye. Amen. He said, how do you see? The man said, I see men as trees walking. I ain't got what I need. Yet. I need more. Amen. Let me tell you, I don't care what method he uses. I don't care how it comes by. I don't care how it touches. I need a touch. Amen. I was with a preacher one time. I won't say who it was. We was over in Panama. Man, he thought he was bigger than Panamanians. And for me, to get out of the country, when I was going,
after I'd been there just a few months. But Arthur, I had to go get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I had to be downtown Panama and get in line to get a number when that place opened up at 8 o'clock. Amen. You had to get in line, be there about 6:30 to even get in line, get a good position to be seen that day. And Sister Dana, there'd be lines of people outside that place. And they'd be waiting to go in and get that number to get a visa to go home. And once you got that visa, you had to go all the way across town to get it stamped and pay another fee. But if you did not have that visa, you could not leave the country. Amen. When they looked at your passport and seen how long you had been there at the airplane ticket office, they'd always say, do you have your departure visa? Amen. I've seen people that were there go to crying and squalling when they told them, said, you ain't leaving today. You've got to have that visa before you ever leave. But on this occasion, this preacher went with me. I'd already been there. I know how the system worked. The first time I went, Brother Justin, I walked in there as an American. I was going to get my visa. I didn't get a number. Amen. I had to come back the next day. They wouldn't even see me or talk to me. I got in there and I got my number. I'm sitting there reading the book. I know it's going to be an all-day affair. Amen. It's about 12:30, 1 o'clock in the evening. And they've only seen about 5 people. I'm number 25 in line. I know it's going to be a long day. This preacher gets restless. We ain't got all day to kill. He walks up and he tells somebody, hey, man, we need to see this young man. He needs to get out of here. I go grab him by the coat and I said, you better hush. You sit right back down or leave. Go somewhere else. I mean, that woman scolded us. She talked to me like she was a dog. And it told me I had no authority in her country and that she could let me go. Or she could make me stay. Hey, man, you know what I did? I didn't bow up and say, hey, you ain't talking to me like that. I've been over there 3 months. I was ready to go home. I said, yes, ma'am. I'll sit back down. I'll wait on you to call my number. You have supreme authority right now over my visa. And I'll wait till you call my name. And when she called me, I said, yes, ma'am, thank you. I appreciate you taking time. I mean, I was nice as I could be. And I got that thing and I left. You hear me? Hey, man, some folks want to try to roughshod God. Tell them what they're going to do. How they're going to get it. Go about their own ways of fixing things. Hey, man, but when you need healing and a touch, you don't care how it comes. As long as it comes. Spit in my eyes. Anoint me with oil. I'll crawl around the church. It don't matter. As long as I get touched. Amen. I got a text yesterday from a young man I've been praying for and dealing with. He said, preacher, I want you to know I'm on my 2nd week of no pills. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, preacher, I want you to know I'm on my 2nd week of no pills. Amen. I talked to him about 3 weeks ago, and I shook his hand. I said, hey, if you want God to deliver you, he can. Amen. But you're going to have to take the first step and be willing to lay some things down. Amen. You want to know what kind of reaction he had? He texted me back. He said, I'm not lying, preacher. I hope you believe me. But 2 drug dealers came by today and wanted to see if I was sick or what had happened because I hadn't bought any pills. And you know what? I texted him back. I said, put them out of business. Amen. Let them know that God's come into the house and things are about to change. Amen. When you really want to touch, you'll lay it down. Amen. God, lead me out of my familiarity. Amen. Get me out of where I've been for years. Amen. What I need is not just another blessing. I just don't need another chill and a thrill. I need to be filled by the power of God. I need a touch in my body. I need a touch in my soul. I'm going to fill my Holy Ghost. I wish somebody make up their mind. Amen. Spittle. It don't matter. Amen. Mud. It don't matter. I just need a touch. I just need a touch. Amen. Here he was. Bible said that Jesus touched that man. Amen. Spit in his eyes. Said, how do you see? Amen. I ain't going to do what Brother Frankie said. Amen. See, when that man said the second time, amen, Brother Frankie got it mixed up. He said, man said, I see clearly. Amen. Brother Frankie said, that man said, I see queer. Amen. Ain't what he saw. Bible said he saw clearly. Amen. Oh, that man saw clearly when God touched his eyes. Oh, come on now. But when Jesus talked to him, he said, what do you see? He said, I see men as trees walking. I believe that Jesus asked him just like he did that man sitting by the pool. He said, what would you that I do? He said, there's no man to take me when the water's troubled. I need healing. You know, he said, he just sat there. And he never tried to get in. I don't believe that. That man wouldn't have come back every time. I believe he tried with everything to get down there. They just beat him to the pool. Hey, but can I tell you tonight, if you're serious? I said, if you're serious about a touch, you'll tell him, I need more. Hey, man, I don't know why he did it in part. I don't know why. I believe he wanted to see how bad this man wanted to see. I mean, if he left now, he's doing better than what he was, wasn't he? I mean, come on now. After he spit in his eyes, he's doing better than what he was. I could see things moving. Hey, man, I see men as trees. I couldn't see that before. That's what a lot of folks do. Hey, man. They say, well, he touched me and I'm good. I just go home. I got enough. Hey, man, but this man didn't do that. He said, I see men as trees walking, and Jesus laid hands on him. I thought about that. I thought about blind Bartimaeus when the crowd said, be quiet. Amen. Blind Bartimaeus cried out all the louder. Amen. Thou son of David, have mercy on me. Amen. Like that widow woman, or like that woman with the issue of blood, the Bible said that she pressed through that crowd. Amen. To get a touch from heaven. And she touched the hem of his garment and was made whole. I come to tell somebody tonight, if you'll press and cry, if you'll stretch out, if you'll call to him, you can leave this house different than what you came. Amen. You come bound and blind. Amen. You come oppressed and depressed by the enemy. But you can leave tonight under the authority of God, healed by his power. I wish we had a blind Bartimaeus in the house that would cry out, son of David, have mercy on me. I wish we had a little lady that will stand up, elbow her way to the altar and say, I come tonight, amen, not just to sing, not just to be in the house of God, but I came for a touch. I said, I came for a touch. Amen. We want somebody to grab us and move for us. Take it from us. And Jesus is saying, amen, I'm leading you out. If you'll follow me, there's healings outside the gate. Amen. There's healing outside this gate. You'll just come with me. And we'll sit on our pew. We'll look around. And we'll wonder who's going to move first. If so-and-so goes, I'll go. If Brother Jim says one more time, that one word might trigger. All the time you feel a tug of the master's hand saying, there's so much more. Don't you want to see clearly? Amen. Don't you want to see? Amen. Don't you want deliverance? Don't you want help and healing? All the time he's tugging at your heart. And you're waiting on somebody else. I said, you're waiting on some song. You're waiting on the altar call. You're waiting on the preacher to say, all stand, everybody come to the altar. Amen. For that opportune moment. All the time you feel that tug. I said, all the time you feel that tug. Amen. I've been there. I know how it is. I've sat in that same place. Amen. But I've been there at times when I had to have a touch from heaven. Amen. There's been times in my life I knew if I didn't get a hold of God, amen, that I wasn't going to make it another day. Amen. I feel like all the demons in hell had gathered around me. I know they got weary with me sometimes at the churches. I'd just jump up out of my seat and I'd say, I need prayer. Amen. Sometimes it was during the preaching. Amen. Sometimes it was during the choir singing. Amen. But I made up my mind, I come too far to turn back. If I have to crawl, amen, if I have to swim, climb every mountain, tread every valley, walk through every burning furnace there is, I'm going to
to do what I can to get to God. Amen. Make it to God's good heaven. I wish somebody get a hold of this tonight. I said, I wish somebody help me preach right now. I wish somebody make up their mind. I've been here long enough. I dwell in this city. They talk about how God came. They talk about how foolish it is. I'm getting out. I'm getting healed. I'm getting help. Amen. I want to see. I wish somebody get a hold of that. I say, I need my sight back. I need deliverance. I need help in my life.
You know, we've got to the point. I'll be careful here. We've got to the point. It is better to be afflicted than to be healed. What do you mean? Well, more people feel sorry for you. Pat you on the back and do for you. It ain't like that. We know it is. I got used to being like this. And the folks around me used to being like this. That's just the way. You ever heard that? That's just them. 20-something years ago, that's just me. I didn't give a care about going to church. I didn't care nothing about things of God. That night I knelt by that bed, I said, man, oh, you hear me? Lord, if you lead me, I'm coming out. Amen. I'm tired of dwelling where I'm at. Amen. I'm tired of the life I'm living. Amen. I made up my mind that night. I've had to run down the streets of Panama. Amen. I've had to go get everybody out of bed and say, listen, I need somebody to pray me through. I was going to wake up the whole house. Amen. I wasn't going to bed lost. I had a terror in my heart about hell. Amen. I was afraid if I went to sleep, TJ, I was going to wake up in the pits of hell. I felt like God's going to take me that night. Amen, but I made up my mind. How is somebody get a made up mind tonight? Amen, come out of that seat and say, I've been blind long enough. I've been dwelling in the city of despair. I've been a place of comfort. Amen, I'm coming out. I'm tired about how they say it ought to be. I'm tired of living the way I'm living. Amen, I'm leaving here a changed man, a changed woman by the power of God. Amen. I wish some of us had childlike faith. I wish some of us had childlike faith. I'm telling you, I don't know what to do. You're waiting on me, and I'm waiting on you. Brother Richard Crane said, they're looking for the apex of the sermon. I've already passed that. We look for the illustration that's going to make us cry. Like the crippled boy or the blind woman. That thing's going to stir our hearts. You just don't want it bad enough. You just don't want it bad enough. If you're waiting on something else. Hey, man, if you're waiting on just a, you ain't got to the place that you want it bad enough. I said, you ain't got to the place that you want it bad enough. Amen. But if you really want it tonight, it wouldn't matter how it came. If you had to step out of your seat and say, listen, that might not be like me, but I'm going to move tonight. I'm going to move tonight because I need help. Oh, God, I'm glad for honest hearts tonight. I said, I'm glad for honest hearts tonight. Amen. There's some more of you need to come out of your seat and come down this altar. Amen. I said, there's some more of you.